Good morning, everybody. And first of all, thank you to the organizers for the chance to talk today a little bit about some of the work that we're doing in the Fletcher Lab aimed at understanding phenotypic variation in influenza A virus. So I'd like to begin today with a decades-old observation, which is that influenza A virus, when you look at clinical isolates, is extremely heterogeneous in its morphology. This is something that we've, over the past several decades, begun to understand at the genetic level. So we can now identify genetic mutations that confer this heterogeneous morphology. And we also know that it can exist in genetically uniform populations. But we know relatively little about the molecular mechanisms that give rise to this variation, and also what its significance is as far as infectivity or virulence. So influenza virus certainly isn't unique in this form of pleomorphism, but it nonetheless stands in contrast to many other enveloped viruses. And as just one example of this, I'll highlight a flavivirus, Zika, which you can see from this electron micrograph is quite uniform in its size and shape. So the contrast between these two viruses extends beyond morphology to also encompass the distribution of proteins on the surface of the virus. So in this EM reconstruction of influenza, hemagglutinin is highlighted in green and neuraminidase is highlighted in gold. And what I hope you can see from this is there's no strong order in the distribution of these two major membrane proteins on the surface of influenza. And again, this is in contrast to the organization of Zika envelope proteins, which are highly regular. So ultimately, what we would like to understand is why some viruses like influenza might favor a strategy where they produce very heterogeneous progeny, while others favor a strategy where their progeny are very homogeneous in comparison. So one way that we can go about starting to do this is to focus in on a single aspect of replication where both the morphology and composition of the virus is directly relevant. And this is the ability of a virus to bind to and detach from targeted cells. So to explain what I mean by this, if we zoom in at the interface between an influenza virion and a targeted cell, we can characterize the binding interaction through the number of hemagglutinin trimers, or HA trimers, on the surface of the virus, and the abundance of sialic acid residues to which HA binds on the surface of the cell. This is complicated somewhat by the fact that the virus also encodes an enzyme, neuraminidase, which cleaves sialic acid. So it, in some sense, is competing with HA. And this can remove the sialic acid residues from the surface of the cell and modulate binding in this way. And this is something that's particularly relevant for the detachment of new progeny virions. Building on a statistical model developed in David Shah's group last year, we can look at this essentially as a two-dimensional plot where we have the number of HAs on one axis and the number of sialic acids on another axis. And the point that I want to emphasize here is that the virus has a number of knobs that it can turn to modulate where it is in this space. So in particular, by changing the morphology of a virus particle, you change the area of the interface between the virus and host. And this changes the number of HAs and the number of sialic acids that are present. In addition to this, the virus can change the HA to NA ratio independent of morphology, and this can change the number of HAs present at the interface. And finally, through the action of neuraminidase, the virus can modulate the amount of sialic acid that's present on the infected cell, and so it can explore this plot along the vertical axis. And this last point is particularly relevant since this is the stage at which the most widely used anti-influenza drugs like Tamiflu or oseltamivir act. So they inhibit neuraminidase and block the detachment of new viruses. So given that morphology and composition give a virus so much flexibility to modulate its ability to bind to cells, we wanted to try and understand how the heterogeneity that I mentioned in the previous slide is influencing these parameters. So how much variation is there in a population of genetically uniform viruses? And building on this, we'd also like to understand what the significance of this variation might be in the infectivity of a virus. So the way that we go about doing this is using fluorescence. So we want to fluorescently label multiple proteins within the virus so that we can use a fluorescence microscope to quantify their abundance. So the first challenge that we encounter, though, when we try to do this is that the traditional ways of labeling proteins in viruses or cells, namely to use GFP or its spectral variants, is simply too disruptive. As a general rule, appending a genetic fusion protein to any of the structural proteins of influenza virus attenuates it substantially. So an alternate approach that we can use that ultimately works is to use instead site-specific labeling. to attach small molecule fluorophores to specific sites that we've engineered in viral proteins that are then expressed endogenously off the viral genome. And so what I mean by this is we can use 5 to 10 amino acid tags that can be placed at the NRC terminus of a protein or inside internal loops. And these tags can be recognized by enzymes that will conjugate a small molecule fluorophore, or it can be bound directly by a fluorescent ligand. Since there's been a number of strategies for doing this type of site-specific labeling developed over the years, we can mix and match so that we can orthogonally label multiple structural proteins within the virus. And then we can use the viruses that we engineer in this way to infect cells and either label the proteins in live infected cells and watch the dynamics of the assembly and budding process, or we can collect the virus and label the proteins and then measure their abundance in individual viruses. Also, if we're careful about how we place these tags, we can recover viruses that harbor multiple versions of the tags, but show the same replication kinetics as the parental strain from which they're derived. So with that description of the system, I want to focus a little bit on now how we can use it. So this is a field of view of filamentous virions. You can see some of them are up to 10 microns or longer in length. In this image, there's 3 different proteins labeled. So the VRNP complex in green, the hemagglutinin in blue, and neuraminidase in red. If we zoom in on this a little bit closer, we can see for some of the filamentous virions, we can start to resolve features with subviral resolution. And in particular, the green foci that you can see at the tips of many of these filaments corresponds to the viral genome. And this localization is consistent with what people have seen using electron microscopy. We can also use images like this now to measure the abundance of different proteins. And so, for example, if we use this to look at the three most abundant membrane proteins of viral origin, HA, NA, and M2, we get relative abundances that are consistent with what people have seen using biochemical methods that average across the population. But what we're now able to do is to look at covariation within individual viruses. And so in particular, when we look at the ratio of hemagglutinin to neuraminidase in individual viruses, instead of the monomodal distributions that we see for the individual proteins, a bimodal distribution shows up, where there's a subset of viruses that are relatively high in NA and lower in HA, and a second subset that's higher in HA and lower in NA. And this is essentially another way that we can look at the same data, where NA is on one axis, HA is on the other, and we can see these two different populations. So we wanted to try and understand where this variation might be coming from. And in particular, if it was arising from cell-to-cell differences in a population of infected cells, or if a single infected cell was capable of producing progeny virions that showed this full range of variation. So in order to do this, we do an experiment where we grow a monolayer of epithelial cells. We infect them at a low MOI, so there's large spatial separation between neighboring infected cells. We then flip them over so that the apical surface is a few tens of microns away from a cover slip that's been functionalized with an antibody that can bind to the virus. And in this way, we can collect virus as a burst essentially on the cover slip that originated from a single infected cell. So this is a typical image that we see for these types of experiments. And when we quantify the abundance of different proteins, as I showed previously for the population-wide data, for the data for viruses coming from a single cell, we start to see the emergence of these two subpopulations. So this is suggesting that a single virus infected with a single cell is capable of reproducing most of the variation that we see for a population of infected cells. So the next step we wanted to take was to try and understand what the significance of this might be for adaptation or infectivity. So one way to look at this is if we start from an individual virus that starts the infection, it produces many progeny that may be broadly distributed within this space. However, if they have a functional neuraminidase, this will push them all into a regime where they're able to detach late in infection. However, if we inhibit neuraminidase through drugs like oseltamivir, this may no longer be the case. So we may split our population into those that can and those that cannot detach from the cell. So we wanted to test this experimentally. And as a first step, we looked at how much sialic acid remains if you infect cells and then treat them with a neuraminidase inhibitor. And what we find is for infected cells that are untreated, essentially they do a very efficient job of removing sialic acid from the surface. However, if we inhibit neuraminidase with 100 nanomolar, close to a physiological dose of oseltamivir, about 50% of the sialic acid remains. So to look at how this affects the phenotype of the virus that's released, we can do an experiment where we infect at a multiplicity of infection of about one. We collect the virus that comes off after a single round of replication. And then we can replace the media with media supplemented with an exogenous sialidase. So this will strip the virus that had stayed bound to the cells. So when we look at the population that's released in the absence of the inhibitor, we see something similar to what I showed before. In the presence of 100 nanomolar of the inhibitor, we see two subtle changes. So first of all, there's lower overall HA content, and there's a slight increase in the occupancy of this higher NA fraction. In contrast, if we look at the viruses that come off when we treat the cells with the exogenous sialidase, we recover this higher HA pool, and then not much comes off in this high NA bin. So this is consistent with what you might expect given the nature of the treatment that we're using, but what remains unclear is to what extent these changes are coming from changes in virus morphology versus changes in the density of specific proteins on the surface of the virus. So we can look at morphology directly by imaging the viruses and measuring length distributions. And when we do this, essentially what we find is that as we increase through the physiological doses of oseltamivir, we essentially lose all of the filamentous particles. And you can see this in the length distribution shown here. If we compare this to virus that comes off only when we strip them with the exogenous sialidase, we find that at the high doses of the oseltamivir, we recover many of the filamentous particles, but it doesn't quite bring us back to the extent that we see for the untreated cells. So this is suggesting that two things might be at play. One is that we're biasing the viruses that release, but we also might be causing permanent changes in the morphology of the viruses that are produced when we inhibit neuraminidase. So with this, I want to close with the idea that phenotypic variation could be a way for a virus to hedge in an unpredictable environment. And while this might not be the most surprising conclusion, I think it's nonetheless potentially interesting to think about why some viruses would favor this strategy while others would produce very homogeneous progeny. But in the context of influenza, a possible model would be that phenotypic variation could assure that some subset of a viral population is well suited for the environment that it finds itself in. And this subset could then go on to infect the next generation of cells. And this essentially would buy the virus time to accumulate the genetic mutations that would lead to a longer lasting, more stable adaptation to the challenges that it's facing. And this is something that becomes particularly relevant when we start to take into account how complicated the virus's growth environment really is. So here are epithelial cells that are differentiated at an air-liquid interface, and on top of the apical surface is a micron-thick layer of mucus. So this is rich in sialic acid and presents both a mechanical and a chemical barrier that the virus needs to navigate. And so I think only by really understanding the biology of influenza virus in a context such as this one can we really fully start to appreciate why phenotypic variation may be advantageous. So with that, I want to close and thank the Fletcher Lab for their support throughout this work and you for your attention, as well as my sources of funding. And I'd be happy to take questions.
How can you and how defective particle could play in your system, because you get potentially, you don't differentiate between the one that are infectious versus the one that are not infectious, right?
So that's something that we're working on now. So what I can say based on the preliminary studies that I've been doing is that, so if we grow virus under different conditions that produce different populations, we can see conditional differences in those viruses' infectivity. So for example, if we try to infect cells where entry is neuraminidase independent or dependent, we see differences depending on whether we're collecting viruses that are enriched or depleted in NA. So it looks like both populations can be infectious, but it may depend on the circumstances that you're testing them in.
Hi, hello. Given that you are getting different infection from the different particle sizes, have you seen any differences in biasing between virus species?
Between different virus species?
No, sorry, not species. Between subtypes of flu,
So we haven't right now tested this in other subtypes. But I think the approach that we're using should be generalizable to other subtypes of influenza, and I think it'd be interesting to look at those. Yeah.
Hi. When you treat the cell with with the inhibitor of neuraminidase, did you try to look at the virus on the cell surface instead of stripped virus out from the cell?
So I've done some experiments like that. One of the challenges there is that the density of virus on the surface of the cell is so high that you can't easily resolve individuals.
I'm wondering if the budding itself is changed, so then you have the different shape of the virus if you don't, the virus cannot be released, actually.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think there's definitely the possibility that we're changing the morphology of the virus when we do the neuraminidase inhibition. It's been something that's challenging to measure on the surface of the cell, again, just because you have such a high density of virus that it's hard to resolve individuals to do that sort of measurement.
Yeah, I'm just curious. Do you know whether the size of the virus affects its burst size?
Whether the size of the virus affects its burst size. So no, I don't have an answer for that. But that's something that we could potentially look at. Yeah.
I was just curious whether your resolution with your three colors allows you not only look at size after the inhibitor treatment, but at other characteristics like mislocalization or different combinations.
Mm-hmm. So one thing that we're doing work on now is looking at the distribution of HA and NA on the surface of virus. So we can do this using super resolution techniques with the approach that I described is compatible with, although I didn't present any of that today. But for long filamentous virions, even without using super resolution, we can see differences in the localization of NA on the surface. So for example, it has a tendency to localize to the poles of filamentous particles. And so that's something that we're certainly interested in. And if you have other thoughts for things that would be interesting to look at, I'd be happy to hear it.
Very good.
Thank you.